Good morning, my dear students. I am Mohammad Bahuddin, working as an assistant professor in ISL Engineering College, which is located in Hyderabad. So today we are going to learn regarding the types of gear. So gears is broadly classified into three types. The first one we can say that parallel shaft gear. Another one is intersecting shaft gear, and third one is non-intersecting and non-parallel shaft gear. This parallel shaft gear is broadly classified into two types. The first one we can say that spur gear, and second one is the helical gear. So the spur gear also broadly classified into two types. First one is the external spur gear, another one is the internal spur gear. This helical gear is also broadly classified into two types. The first one is single helical gear, another one is double helical gear. Sometimes we can say that it is a herringbone gear. Okay, this intersecting shaft is broadly classified into several types. The first one we are going to discuss regarding the bevel gear, another one is coniflex bevel gear, zero bevel gear, and another one is spiral bevel gear, and fifth one is meter gear, and sixth one is angular gear, and seventh one is crown gear. In the non-intersecting and non-parallel shafts, in which we are going to discuss regarding the three types, the first one is the cross helical gear, another one is hypoid gear, third one is worm gear. The first of all, we are going to discuss regarding the spur gear. Okay, so this spur gear, it's a one type of the mechanical device. It is mainly used for transmit the power between two shafts. The teeth on this gear are cut straight and parallel to the shaft to which they are attached. So let us see over here. So first thing is, these spur gear are used to transmit the power from one shaft to the another shaft. Is it right? So let us see over here. This is what we can say. We can say that this is the axis of the shaft, or we can say that it is a gear axis. So this is, let us see this figure. This is, we can say that it is a axis of the shaft. Clear? And this one we can say that it is a teeth on the gear. So in the spur gear, the teeth are parallel to the shaft. Teeth are parallel to the shaft. So let us see. So this is the teeth of the spur gear. Teeth of the spur gear. This teeth of the spur gear is parallel to the axis of the shaft. So such type of the gear we can say that spur gear. So let us see over here. We having the two shaft. One is the driver shaft, another one is the driven shaft. So this driver gear, we can say that it is a gear. The bigger one, we can say that it is a gear. And the smaller one, we can say that it is a pinion. We can say that it is a pinion. So let us see over here. This gear is rotated in the, which direction? Is in anti-clockwise direction. Anti-clockwise direction. And the driven gear is rotated in the clockwise direction. So this means that the driver gear always rotate opposite directions of the driven gear. If it is rotated in the anti-clockwise direction, this driven gear also rotate opposite directions of the driver gear. opposite direction in the sense this driver gears is rotated in the anti-clockwise direction and this driven gears is rotated in the clockwise direction. As well as this teeth, okay, or this teeth is parallel to the, this teeth is parallel to the axis of the shaft, we can say that it is a spur gear. So this spur gear is widely used in the industrial application. So nowadays we are using in the clocks, as well as nowadays we are using in the washing machines, as well as we are using in the household appliances purpose, we are using the spur gear, as well as we are using the spur gear in the pumps, as well as we are using in the aerospace and aircraft, and nowadays we are using in the railway and trains in which we are using the spur gear. So spur gear is also broadly classified into two types. The first one is the external spur gear, another one is the internal spur gear. So I hope so, no one is having a doubt. Again, I will repeat here. So spur gear is mainly used for transmit the power between these two shaft, between the two shaft. The teeth on this gear, how's it, are cut straight and parallel to the shaft. So the teeth of this gear should be parallel to the axis of the shaft. So this spur gear nowadays we are using in the clocks, as well as we are using in the pumps, as well as in the washing machine, as well as the household applications in which we are using the spur gear. So nowadays also we are using in the aerospace and aircraft in which we are using the spur gear. Next one is external spur gear. So external spur gear nothing but these two gears, the driver gear and the driven gear. This driver gear and the driven gear are meshing externally. Okay, so let us see over here. This one we can say as driver gear, and this one we can say as driven gear. This driver gear is rotated in the clockwise direction, and this driven gear is rotated opposite direction of the driver gear. So this driver gear, we can say that it is a gear. And this driven gear, the smallest gear, the biggest gear we can say as gear, and the smallest gear we can say that pinion. What we can say here? Pinion. These gears and pinions are meshing externally. Is it right? So the teeth are contact at the contact surface. So for such type of the gears, we can say that external spur gear. Next one is internal spur gear. So the internal spur gauge in which the teeth are meshing internally. The teeth are meshing internally. So this bigger one gear, we can say that it is the annular, and the smallest gear we can say that it is a pinion. So let us see over here. The bigger gear, we can say that it is the annular, and the smallest gear, we can say that it is a pinion. So this annular and the pinion are meshing internally. So they're meshing internally. The such type of the gear, we can say that internal spur gear. Clear here? Next one is helical gear. So this helical gear are cut at an angle to the face of the gear. So first of all, you need to remember one thing. So this helical gears, should be similar to the spur gear, because the one shaft is parallel to the another shaft. The first thing is, So let us see this figure. This is the figure of the helical gear. So this is first shaft, and this is another shaft. So this first shaft is parallel to the another shaft. Is it right? So the bigger one, we can say that it is a helical. What we can say here? We can say as helical. And the smaller one, we can say that it is a pinion. What we can say here? Pinion. But here, this teeth, it is a making an angle with an axis of the shaft. If this teeth is making an angle, this angle, we can say that it is a helix angle. What we can say here? We can say that it is a helix angle. Let us see this here. So this is our teeth of the helical gear, and this one we can say that it is the axis of the shaft. What we can say here? We can say that it is the axis of the shaft. So let us see. So these teeth, how is it? The teeth are inclined to the axis of the shaft. So let us see over here. The teeth are inclined to the axis of the shaft. These teeth are inclined to the axis of the shaft. This inclined teeth is making the angle of alpha. So this making the angle of alpha, this angle we can say that it is a helix angle. What we can say here? We can say that it is a helix angle. Clear? So let us see over here. The teeth on the helical gear are cut at an angle. So this means that the teeth of the gear is making this some angle with the axis of the shaft. Okay? And second one is, this gradual engagement make helical gear operate much more than smoothly and quietly than spur gear. So this means that, so this helical gear, it is mainly used for carrying the heavier load, as well as they can easily operate compared to the spur gear. So we can easily operate smoothly. So for that reasons, we are giving the more priority to the helical gear instead of spur gear. Okay, dear? As well as third point, if the angle of the gear teeth are correct, they can be mounted on the perpendicular shaft, adjusting the rotating angle by the 90 degree. So this shaft, how is it? The shaft, it is making the angle of 90 degree. So let us see over here. This is our axis of the shaft. This shaft, it is making the angle. If you observe here, they making the angle of 90 degree. They're making the angle of 90 degree from the axis of the shaft. Okay, and the shaft should be perpendicular. It should be making the angle of 90 degree with the axis of the another shaft. Clear? And this helical gear resembles the spur gear, but the teeth are cut an angle of angle rather than parallel to the axis shaft like on the spur gear. So, but we know very well, if you observe the helical gear, so this helical gear, they're making the angle of how much? They're making the angle of lesser than 20 degree. Is it right? They're making the angle of 20 degree to avoid the excessive thrust load purpose. We are making the angle of 20 degree of the helical gear. If you exceed the gear angle, if it is more than 20 degree, they have the possibility to avoid the excessive end thrust. So for that reason, the angle should not exceed. It should not exceed the 20 degree. The angle should not exceed the 20 degree to avoid excessive end thrust. Okay, dear? So what is the characteristics of the gear? So let us see. The first thing is, if you want to observe the helical gear, so this helical gear is having the more strength compared to the spur gear. Compared to the spur gear, as well as the teeth are longer than the, this teeth of the helical gears are longer than the spur gear. And the second thing is, this helical gear carrying the maximum load, they carrying the maximum load compared to the spur gear. And it can be used to connect parallel shaft as well as non-parallel shaft as well as non-intersecting shaft. They have the characteristics of the gear. Okay, so, and it is a quieter even at the higher speed and the more durable. For that reason, we are giving the more priority to the helical gear. And what is the limitations of the helical gear? So gear in mesh produce the thrust force in the axial direction. So if these gears are meshing externally, so they produce the thrust force in the axial direction. They produce the thrust force in the axial direction. Is it right? So for that is the limitations of the helical gear. And if you observe this helical gear is more expensive than the spur gear. And so what is the applications of the helical gear? So the applications of the helical gears nowadays, we are using to carry the heavier load in the automobile application purpose, as well as the speed of this helical gear should be greater than the spur gear. Okay dear. Next one is herringbone gear. This herringbone gears, sometime we can say as double gear. What we can say? Double helical gear, we can say that. So this herringbone gear is a specific type of the double helical gear, which is to side to side, not to face, combination of two helical gear of the opposite hand. So let us see over here. So this one, we can say that it is the teeth of the helical gear. So this one, we can say that it is the axis of the shaft okay dear. So here, this is the single helical gear. Here another one is, one more gear is geared toward the right side. The shape of this helical gear or herringbone gear is the shape of V shape. Is it right? So let us see over here. This teeth, this is the first teeth of the helical gear, and this is the second teeth of the helical gear. The shape of this teeth should be, how is it? The shape of V shape. Is it right? So here, this herringbone gear is the double helical gear. So we are using the two helical gears. We are using, this is the first helical gear and this is the second helical gear. So the shape of this herringbone gear is in V shape. But the sides to side, not face to face, because if you observe here, this how it is attached, this helical gear, one gear attached towards side by side, not face to face. Is it right? If it is face to face will be there, so this gear should be mounted opposite directions. So we can say that it should be side by side. So we can say that it should be face to face. But we are talking about these gears are fixed in the nature by the side to side. Is it right? So combination of the two helical opposite hand side. So this one is toward upward direction, toward right side, and this gear toward upward direction toward the left side, like this. Let us see this figure. This is upward direction toward the right side, and this is upward direction toward the left hand side. The shape should be in the cones, we can say that, or we can say it is in the shape of V shape. So nowadays this herringbone gear or the double gear is widely used for carrying for the heavy load purpose. We are using the herringbone gear. So herringbone gear is carrying the maximum load compared to the single helical gear. Clear here? Then next one is intersecting shaft. So in the intersecting shafts, first of all we are going to discuss regarding the bevel gear. So this bevel gear is mainly used for transmit the power at a constant velocity. So they transmit the power at constant velocity okay here. So the ratio between the two shaft woods whose axis intersect at a certain angle. So let us see over here. First thing is, this is one, we can say that it is a pinion. The smallest one we can say that it is a pinion, and the bigger one we can say that it is a bevel gear. What we can say here, the bigger one we can say that it's a bevel, and the smaller one we can say that it is a pinion. So these are usually mounted on the shaft whose angle is 90 degree. So let us see, this is the hole of the shaft and this is also hole of the shaft. If you draw the axis of the shaft, okay, if you draw the axis of the shaft, okay, okay, this is the axis of the shaft of the bevel gear. So this one, the bigger one, we can say that it's a bevel gear, and the smaller one we can say that it is a pinion. Clear here? And this is axis of the shaft, it should be perpendicular. This axis of the shaft, it should be perpendicular to the 90 degree. How's it here? It should be perpendicular to the 90 degree. So these are usually mounted on the shaft that are 90 degree, but they can be designed to the work at the other angle also. So it can be designed on the basis of 90 and it basis of 110 we can design. But the main thing, we are giving the more priority, they making the angle of 90 degree also. So this bevel gear is nowadays we are using in the marine applications as well as we are using in the automobile sector, in which we are using the bevel gear. Nowadays we are using the printing press machines, in which we are using this bevel gear. In the power plant, engineering, in the power plant, in which we are using the bevel gear, as well as in the steel plant, in which also we are using the bevel gear. So the applications of the bevel gears, in which we are used in the pumps, as well as in the power plant, as well as we are using in the automobile, as well as in the marine application purpose, we are using this bevel gear. So again I will repeat this one dear, because some of the students is having a lot of confusions regarding the bevel gear. So the bigger one we can say that bevel, and the smallest one we can say that it is a pinion. So this bevel axis, this bevel or axis of the shaft, this is the axis of the shaft. What we can say here, axis of the shaft should be perpendicular to the, should be perpendicular to the pinion of the axis of the shaft. So this is the pinion axis of the shaft, is it right? The pinion axis of the shaft. The bevel gear axis of the shaft should be perpendicular to the pinion axis of the shaft, they making the angle of 90 degree. The such type of the gear, we can say that it is a bevel gear. Okay dear? And next one is, we are going to discuss about the meter gear. So these meter gears are two identical gear. So which exception that both the gears always have the same number of the teeth. So let us see this gear. Okay, so above one is the pinion, and second one we can say that it's a meter gear, or we can say that it's a gear. Is it right? So this gear and the pinion is having the same number of teeth. So if the pinion is having the 28 teeth, means the gear should be having the same 20 number of teeth. So that's what we can say that is a meter gear. So why I'm using this meter gear? So they provide, the first thing is they provide the steady ratio. Other characteristics are similar to the same bevel gear. So nowadays these bevel gears we are using in the conveyor, as well as we are using in the elevators, as well as in the kilns, in which we are using this meter gear. So in this gear, the gear having the same ratio is in the ratio of 1:1. So this means that if the gear is having the number of teeth is 28, means the pinion should be having the number of teeth should be 28. So that's what the ratio of the meter gear should be always 1:1. So therefore not used when the applications call for the change in speed. So the first step of the gears is not used for the change of speed purpose. So they can easily maintain the constant velocity. For that reasons we are giving the priority the first step of the meter gear. And next one is non-intersecting and non-parallel shaft. So non-intersecting, nothing but the shaft of the gear is not intersecting at a particular point, as well as the not parallel to the axis of the shaft. Not parallel to the axis of the shaft. The such type of the gear, we can say that non-intersecting and the non-parallel shaft. So let us see over here. So we are, first of all, we are going to discuss about the hypoid gears. Okay, so these hypoid gears are a modification of the spiral bevel gear. Clear? But so here, this is this smaller one. Okay. So this hypoid gear, it's a modification of the spiral bevel gear, but axes are different. So let us see over here, this the smaller gear, we can say that it's a pinion, and the biggest gear we can say that it's a crown. What we can say here, we can say as the crown. So let us see, this is the axis of the shaft. What we can say here, this is the axis of the shaft, and this is the axis of the crown shaft. Axis of the crown shaft, this pinion is not meeting at the particular point, not meeting at the particular point, as well as this pinion should not, the pinion of the axis of the shaft, the pinion of the axis of the shaft should not be parallel to the crown of the axis of the shaft. So let us see, this is, we can say that crown of the axis of the shaft, axis of the shaft. Clear? So how is it these offset, nothing but they are making the some angle. Let us see over here. If you observe over here, this is our circle. If the pinion is mounted here, so we can say that it is a, should be perpendicular. But this pinion, so the pinion is mounted away from the axis. So away from the axis here, this pinion is mounted away from the axis. So such type of the axis, we can say that it is the offset. What we can say? Offset. So from the center distance, they're making the some distance on which this pinion is mounted we can say that it is the offset angle. What we can say here? We can say that it's the offset angle. So the major advantage of these haploid gears, the gear designs are pinion diameter is should be, we need to increase as well as stronger than the corresponding bevel gear pinion. And the increase the diameter size of the pinion permit the use of computer high gear ratio. So they have the possibility of that. If you increase the diameter of the pinion, they have the possibility to increase the gear ratio. For that reasons, we need to increase the diameter of the pinion. It is a base on the crown. Clear? Next one is worm gear. So worm gear, it is mainly used for transmit the power between the two shaft. So that are right angle to each other as well as that are non-intersecting with each other. That's the step of the gear we can say that is a worm gear. So these worm gears are special gear that resemble the screw that can be used to draw the spur gear or helical gear. So let us see over here. This one. How it is motion here? The motion of this one, it is a linear motion. And the motions is, how is it? The motion is circular motion, or we can say that it's a rotation motion. It is a rotation motion. Okay. So the main function is it convert the rotation motion to the linear motion. So this one, the linear motion, we can say as a rack, and this rotation motions, we can say that it is the pinions. What we can say here? We can say that it is a pinion. So main intention of this worm gear, it's convert the rotations motion to the linear motions. The rotation motion to the rotation motion. So the linear motions, so how is it? In the form of rag. So in the form of rag. So if it is, this gears will be rotating. So this linear gears or rag is move in a linear direction as well as this gear is move in the rotation direction. So the third step of the gear, we can say that it is a worm gear. So this worm gears nowadays we are using in the instrument as well as we are using in the lift elevators, in which we are using the worm gear, as well as we are using in the automobile, in which we are using for the steering mechanisms. So if you draw, so here our, let us see over here, this is our steering. Okay, so this steering is connected to the rotational motions. And then this rotation motions is connected to the linear motions. So if you rotate to the wheel, okay, in the clockwise direction, if you rotate the wheel in the clockwise direction, due to this pinions also rotate in the clockwise direction, but this linear rack is rotated the opposite directions of the pinion. So if the pinions if rotate in the clockwise direction, then this rack is rotated in the opposite directions of the pinion. Clear? So for that reasons, we are using in the steering systems in which we are using the worm gear. Next one is the most important is gear nomenclature. The first of all, we have to discuss about the pitch circle. So let us see over here, the pitch circle nothing but it's one type of the imaginary circle. So let us see this figure. So this one, what we can say? We can say that it is an imaginary circle. This green line it is indicate, or red line is indicate, it is an imaginary circle. That found that where the tooth of the two gears are meshing internally. So diameter of the pitch circle we can say as the pitch diameter. So let us see over here. So this one gear, or we can say that it is a
driven gear, another one is the driver gear. So this driven gear, if it is rotated in the clockwise direction, then this driver gear is rotated in the anti-clockwise direction. If this both gear is rotated in the opposite direction, then these teeth are, these lines is meshing at a particular point, the such type of the line, what we can say, such type of the circle, what we can say that it is a pitch circle. The pitch circle is, it's a one type of the imaginary circle where the teeth of the two gear, so this is the first driver gear, as another one is the driven gear, are mesh at a particular point, the such type of the gear, such type of the circle, we can say that it is a pitch circle. Okay, another one is outside diameter. The outside diameter, nothing but, let us see this figure. Okay. Okay, the outside circle is the distance around the outer edge of the gear. The diameter of the outside circle, the diameter of this outside circle, we can say as outside diameter. The diameter of the inside circle, we can say as inside diameter. What we can say here? The diameter of the outside circle, we can say as outside diameter. The diameter of the inside circle, we can say as inside diameter. So let us see. So this is our last boundary point or external boundary of this gear. If you measure from the bottom to the top, so this type of the gear, what we can say as the outside diameter. What we can say, if you measure from the bottom to top distance, so the such type of the diameter of the circle, we can say as the outside diameter. If you measure from here to here, so the diameter of the circle, diameter of the inside circle, diameter of the inside circle, we can say as the inside diameter. The diameter of the outside circle, diameter of the outside circle, we can say as the outside diameter. As the diameter of the inside circle, we can say as the inside diameter. So next one is root. The bottom portion of the gear tooth, we can say as root. Okay, let us see over here. If you observe in this figure, then you can easily understand here, dear. This is the this bottom. Okay, this bottom of the gear tooth, what we can say, we can say that it is, we can say as root. What we can say here, we can say as the root. And the top portion of the gear tooth, we can say as crest. What we can say here? Crest. The bottom of the teeth or tooth, we can say as root, and the top portion of the teeth, we can say as crest. Okay, dear? Then, if you're joining from top crest to the here, we can say as flank. What we can say? Flank. And next one is pitch point. Let us see over here. Pitch point, the point where the gear teeth actually make contact with each other on the pitch circle. On the pitch circle, we can say at it's a, we can say as pitch point. Let us see. This is one gear, and this is another gear. This gear we can say as driver gear, and this one we can say as it is the driven gear. So these gear teeth actually make contact with each other on the pitch circle, on the pitch circle. So such type of the point we can say as pitch point. What we can say here? We can say as pitch point. So next one is face. what we can say as face. The face nothing but it is a part of the tooth above the pitch surface. Above the pitch surface. So let us see over here. This is the pitch point or pitch circle. This is our pitch circle. So this above the pitch circle, we can say that the part of the teeth above the pitch surface. Above the pitch surface, we can say that it is a face. So if the part of the teeth below the pitch surface, we can say that it is a, we can say as flank. What we can say here? We can say as flank. Then next one is tooth thickness. The width of the tooth arc distance measured on the pitch circle, we can say as tooth thickness. So if you want to measure, so from this point to this point, we can say as it is a tooth thickness. The thickness of the each teeth, the thickness of the each teeth, we can say as the tooth thickness. So, or we can say that it is the arc distance. Arc distance we are measured on the, this arc distance we are measured on the circle, we can say that it is a tooth thickness. Clear here? Next one is addendum. So addendum nothing but it is a radial distance. Okay, so addendum nothing but it is a radial distance of the tooth from the pitch circle to the top of the tooth. So let us see over here. This is the pitch circle. What we can say here? We can say as the pitch circle. The this one we can say as the radial distance of the tooth from the above the teeth, above the pitch circle. This above the pitch circle, what we can say? We can say as the addendum circle. So below the pitch circle, the radial distance below the pitch circle, we can say as dedendum. The radial distance, this one, what we can say here? Here we can say as the radial distance. The radial distance of the pitch circle, distance of the pitch circle. Okay, the radial distance of the pitch circle, if the radial distance above the pitch circle, above the pitch circle, we can say as the addendum. The radial distance of the pitch circle below the pitch circle, we can say as dedendum. Let us see over here. Addendum nothing but it is a radial distance of the teeth from the pitch circle to the top of the teeth. The pitch circle to the top of the teeth, from here to here. So we can say as addendum. Okay, the radial distance of the teeth of the pitch circle below the or bottom of the teeth, from here to here, we can say as the dedendum. What we can say here? Dedendum. So what is the meaning of addendum circle? So addendum circle nothing but it is a circle drawn through the top of the teeth and concerned or concentric with the pitch circle. Let us see. So if you draw one arc here, okay, so it is a meshing over here. We are measuring, we are drawing the circle on the face of the tooth, above the face of the tooth, we can say as addendum circle. The addendum circle nothing but is a circle drawn through the top of the teeth. So this is the top of the teeth. The circle is drawn through the top of the teeth and concerned and concentric with the pitch circle. And concentric with the pitch circle, we can say that it is the addendum circle. What we can say here? We can say as addendum circle. What is the dedendum circle? The dedendum circle nothing but it is a circle is drawn through the bottom of the teeth. If you are drawn the bottom of the teeth, bottom of the teeth is called as dedendum circle. What we can say here? We can say as dedendum circle. Okay, I hope so no one is having the confusion. Okay, if you have the confusion regarding anyone, then you can write in the comment box, and don't forget to subscribe my channel here. Thank you.